Praise God, hallelujah. God is good all the time. His name is to be praised from the rising of the sun to the going down of the same. Hallelujah. You're welcome from wherever you're watching all over the world. And I believe that today we will have a good time in God's presence. In the name of Jesus Christ. Before I get into what we have for today, I'd like for us to say a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for yet another day. This is the day that you have made. We have begun to rejoice and we will continue to rejoice and be glad in it. We thank you for the gift of life. We appreciate you, mighty Father. It's of your mercies that we are not consumed because your compassions fail not. We ask this day, Lord, that you will give us understanding, that you will make our understanding fruitful so that we can walk more accurately in fulfilling your plan and purpose for our lives in the earth in the name of Jesus. Thank you, everlasting Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen and amen. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Okay, we're looking at the subject. You're welcome. Welcome. Please share and get your friends and family to be part of what we're doing today. Today we're looking at what's wrong with imagination. It's the month of vision. All right. We have been discussing on the subject of vision. And in one of the previous broadcasts, I had said that vision is the ability to catch a glimpse of the sum total of God's plan for your life. And this is very important because we must all appreciate the fact that there is a plan, and the plan in question predates our existence and it predates the establishment of the world, the existence of this world. And that plan is what we need to have a glimpse into for us to be able to live a meaningful life on earth. Praise God. So if you do not have, or if you're not privy to that agenda, it's important that you're privy to that agenda so that you can make meaning of your life while you have breath in your nostrils. And in all of the teachings, I have tried to make us to understand the distinction between vision and imagination, or vision and what you would call ambition. All right. Vision is from God, essentially from God. While ambition can be self-initiated, it can be something that you came about because of the things that you see around you, because of the, you know, what people are doing around you. But vision essentially comes from God. And we saw how Habakkuk told us, the prophet Habakkuk told us in Habakkuk chapter 2, he said, I will stand upon my watch and I will set me upon the tower. I will watch to see what he will say unto me, what God will say unto me, and what I shall answer when I am reproved. And in verse 2, he says, God said, write the vision and make it plain, you know, that he may run that reads it, that he may run that readeth it. So essentially, vision comes from God. And that's what we have tried to establish. I also made mention of the fact that when the people came together in Genesis chapter 11, the Bible says that they had one language, they had one speech, okay, and they came together and were having discussions with each other, and they said, come, let's build us a tower and a city whose top may reach to the heavens, okay? It sounded like a laudable project, like a worthy cause, a noble cause that was worth giving everything, your resources, your time, your energy too. But in the middle of the project, we found out that God said that first of all, what they had embarked upon, they would accomplish, you know, because it was coming from their imagination, it was coming from their mind. But God then said that we have to put a stop to this, and eventually that project was aborted. And Bible says that their language was confounded and they went, you know, all over the earth. And I said that happened because what they set out to do was not contained in God's blueprint for humanity. It wasn't contained in God's blueprint for their lives. Important things to note was that they wanted to show off themselves. He said, you know, that we may make a name for ourselves, lest we be scattered abroad over the nations of the earth. So the idea was for self-aggrandizement. The idea was for their own personal agenda. And then we also saw in the course of this teaching in the month, the parable of the rich fool, the man whose land brought forth plentifully, okay? And, you know, he sat down and said to himself, he asked a question. He said, what will I do? Because what the harvest that was coming was a lot more than the storehouse he had that could not contain it. So naturally, you would need to build bigger barns, all right? So he went ahead and said, well, I will break my old storehouse and I will raise a new storehouse. And there was practically nothing wrong with doing that. But then he went on in his monologue, in the conversations that he was having within himself. And what he began to say was that this is all about me, this is all for me. And at the point, God came to him and said to him, you're a fool. Your soul will be required of you tonight. And God was saying that because the man in question was making plans for a future that he was not going to be a part of. In God's plan and in God's agenda, his time was running up. In a few hours, he was going to be no more. And so what he had provided was not meant for what he was proposing. He was proposing that these things would be for him, for his own enjoyment. But God said, if you have an understanding of timing, you would know that your time is going to be up in a matter of hours. And as such, what he needed to have done with what he had gotten was completely different, according to God's plan, was completely different from what he was proposing. And then God posed a question and said, whose shall these things be that he has provided? Okay, so when you begin to have thoughts, when you begin to have ideas, when you begin to have imagination that you call a vision, you know, and the only beneficiary of that vision is yourself, it's an ambition and not a vision, okay? Vision that comes from God, it reaches out onto people, even it outlives you. Vision that comes from God has eternal value. Vision that comes from God is meant to impact the lives of people and not yourself. And that's why in James, the Apostle James said that you have not because you ask not. And then he says, you ask and receive not, because you want to consume it upon your own lust. All right, so when you are the center of a course, when you are the center of an initiative, when you are the center of what you regard as a vision, it is not a vision, it is an ambition. Okay, so you've got to watch where your thoughts are leading you to. Are they leading you to yourself, or they are leading you to God? Are they leading you to your own pocket, or they are leading you to God, who will now direct the affairs of your life according to the blueprint that he has for you? So, I mean, all of this we said so that we can have an understanding of what vision is and what ambition is, and how that whatever thoughts that we have or whatever imaginations that we have must be submitted to God before, you know, you can start to run with them. So today I'm looking at the subject, what's wrong with imagination? What is wrong with imagination? Imagination is very important. Excuse me. It's very important because what that simply means is that we are processing information, we are processing thoughts, we are processing ideas, okay? It's very important, it's very cardinal to our existence, all right? But there is what to do to imagination, all right? For it to really be able to give or be an expression of God's vision for our lives, for our homes, for our families, for our organizations, the organizations we preside over, for communities and for the state. A lot is happening across the nations of the world. And you wonder how that people think that the blood of other people, you know, is, I mean, their ambition in life, political ambition or leadership ambition or whatever it is that they call a vision that they are pursuing, you know, is what people's blood. You see a lot of terrible things happening out there. That's just an ambition, and people will do anything for their ambition to come to light. That's what the scripture says about Satan in John chapter 10, verse 10. It says, the thief comes not but for to steal. Okay, so the primary objective and the primary agenda of the thief is to steal, all right? But where anything comes in between, where anything tries to threaten that agenda, then he switches over to destruction of lives. It switches over to killing, to maiming, to murdering, and then to destruction of lives and property and whatever it is, just to get, to achieve. There is no vision at all. A vision that is vision in its true sense, that is worth the death of somebody else, that is worth the shedding of somebody else's blood, that is worth the destruction of lives and property of somebody else. You know, whatever it is that you're pursuing in life, if human beings have to be sacrificed for you to get there, then it was never a vision from God. It is purely a product of your imagination. And so today, the key scripture, the anchor scripture, is from Proverbs chapter 19. Proverbs chapter 19 and verse 21. God put this scripture in my heart, and it's a very, very profound scripture. There are many devices in a man's heart. Nevertheless, the counsel of the Lord, that shall stand. I want to appreciate those who are joining me here already. Joy Kika, I appreciate you. Oluwa Kemiaro Jolu, that's my wife, I appreciate you. Pastor Lawa Olaide, I appreciate you for joining. Thank you. Okay, so it says, there are many devices in a man's heart. Nevertheless, the counsel of the Lord, that shall stand. Okay, I want us to look at some very, very key words in this scripture. And the first key word in this scripture is the word devices. Devices here, it has the Hebrew name Makhashabal. And what it means in Hebrew is thought, plan, purpose, invention. Okay, so if you go back to that scripture, Proverbs 19:21, and we read it again with this understanding, it's going to give you, you know, a better meaning. There are many devices in a man's heart. Devices there would mean thoughts. Okay, it would mean thoughts, and thought is imagination. Thoughts are the products of imagination. They are things that you think. Okay, there are many thoughts in a man's heart. Nevertheless, the counsel of the Lord, that shall stand. And that word counsel also talks about a plan, a purpose. And he's saying it is God's plan that stands. It's God's purpose that stands. And I said to us that there is a plan, okay? And that plan predates your existence. It predates my existence, a plan for your life, a plan for my life. And we saw that expressed in Jeremiah chapter 1. If you read from verse 4, 5 downwards, there God had a conversation with the prophet Jeremiah. And he said, before I formed you in your mother's womb, I knew you. In other words, ever before you materialized, ever before you came to be, I already had a plan, and my plan was to send you into this world and make you a prophet, ordain you a prophet. As a matter of fact, I had concluded every arrangement even before you were conceived, even before you were formed in your mother's womb, even before you were given birth to. I had concluded all of that arrangement. You had been anointed, you had been ordained for a specific assignment, for a particular assignment. And that goes for every single human being on the face of the earth, because God will not do anything without a reason, and he will not do anything without a purpose. All right. And until you have a glimpse into this purpose or into this plan of God for your life, you do not have a vision in the true sense of a vision. If you are running with any agenda that is not a product of that which was revealed to you or that which was given to you by God, by whatever means he has chosen to pass that across to you, it's not a vision. You are simply running with an ambition. And there is a danger with running with an ambition, all right, if it was not given to you by God, or if it had not gone through clearance with God. This word devices occurs 56 times in the Bible, all right, and in the King James Version of the Bible, it occurs as thought, as the word thought 28 times, as the word device 12 times, as the word purpose 6 times, as work 3 times, as imagination 3 times, as cunning or devised or invented or means once in each of the instances, right? So that word devices is thoughts. That word devices is imagination. That word devices is purpose. However, these are a product of your own agenda, personal agenda, your own personal machination, your own personal arrangement. All right. If you look at Job chapter 21 and verse 27, the Bible says, behold, I know your thoughts and the devices which ye wrongfully imagine against me. So we see here the relationship between thoughts and devices. Devices are thoughts, they are your imagination. All right. So when Bible says in Job chapter 5 verse 12, for example, he disappointed the devices of the crafty so that their hands cannot perform their enterprise, what scripture is simply saying there is that the thoughts, the imagination, okay, of the crafty is disappointed, is met with a roadblock, so that he is unable to bring to materiality or to fruition what he has in his mind. Okay? And that is what exactly happened to our guys at the Tower of Babel, Genesis chapter 11. So what happened was that their devices were disappointed. Devices being thoughts, devices being imagination, devices being their own personal agendas, all right? It was disappointed. And so they could not bring to full materiality. They could not bring to fruition that which they had envisaged or that which they had thought in their heart. Praise God forevermore. So the point really is that your imagination can only pass for what is worth running after when you bring it to God for clearance. If you look at Proverbs chapter 11, verse 14, Bible says here, where no counsel is, the people fall. But in the multitude of counselors, there is safety. And the point is that every time you want to do anything in life, you must access the counsel of God. Why? The Bible makes us to understand that it's only the counsel of God that has eternal value. From our opening scripture, it says, nevertheless, the counsel of the Lord that shall stand. The counsel of the Lord that shall stand. In other words, we're talking about God's own idea. We're talking about God's own opinion. We're talking about what God's own thoughts, what God thinks about it. Jeremiah chapter 29 verse 11 says, I know the thoughts that I think towards you. I have some thoughts concerning you. I mean, you are not just existing by accident. You are not just existing, you know, by some Big Bang theory, as it were. I brought you into this life, and I brought you into this life for a purpose. Now, you cannot come into this life and begin to operate without having an understanding of why you are here, without having a glimpse into the reason for which you have been brought into this earth. So, where scripture says there are many devices in a man's heart, it emphasizes that the counsel of the Lord is what will stand. If you look at that Genesis chapter 11 again, God made certain submissions. He said that what these guys have imagined to do will see the light of day. I want you to realize that result is not proof of the veracity of that which you are pursuing. It's not proof of the veracity of your imagination, what you call vision, but it's actually imagination. There are so many things in the world today that in truth and indeed ought not to have seen the light of day. But because, you know, whatever you process with your imagination, whatever you are determined to accomplish, it will come to pass. It explains why our world is plagued with all kinds of wickedness, with all kinds of troubles, with all kinds of evil as we see it today. Many devices in the hearts of men have, you know, found their way into the earth. Why? Because whatever you imagine to do will see the light of day. God only gave us that picture to help us to realize that what happens ultimately to every vision is that every imagination that is not a product of his vision concerning us is that it doesn't have eternal value, and then it consumes the persons that are directly involved. So you see a lot of wickedness in the world today. It's a product of the devices in men's hearts. It's a product of, what people have nursed in their heart, what people have imagined in their heart. But God says that the only thing that has eternal value, the only thing that remains forever, the only thing that blesses generation, you know, to generation, and is worthy of reward, is what is in alignment with his counsel. Okay, so when we say that where no counsel is, the people fall, but in the multitude of counselors, there is safety. That's in Proverbs 11, 14. The implication here is that no matter how brilliant an idea sounds, you cannot run with it unless you get clearance from God. And I'm speaking to you because you are people that God, you know, is very much interested in. God is interested in humans. The Bible says that he loved the whole world, that he sent his only begotten son. You know, he gave his only begotten son. So ideally, what God expects of man is that every time an idea comes up in your heart, every time a thought pops up in your heart, you must submit it for clearance before God. Otherwise, if you run with a vision, if you run with an imagination that you call a vision without having cleared it before God, you will be running with something that is going to run contrary to God's plan and purpose for your life. Your imagination is not a note of finality. It must be submitted to God for clearance. And that's why in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5, the Bible says, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. If you look at Proverbs chapter 15, verse 22, it says, without counsel, purposes are disappointed, but in the multitude of counselors, they are established. Because once you submit the thoughts in your heart, once you submit the ideas in your heart to counsel, to not just a counsel that is coming from you or from one person, but to a multitude of counselors, you are going to hear the voice of God. You are going to get the verdict of God on such matters. So you don't run with an imagination until you have submitted it to God for clearance. Okay? Imagination that is not brought to the obedience of God, to the obedience of Christ, there's everything wrong with it. Because that thought, that imagination is going to lead you away from God. It will lead you to yourself, and it's going to lead you into destruction. In Proverbs 20:18, it also stresses that point. Every purpose, every agenda, every plan, every thought is established by counsel, and with good advice make war. Counsel. And in this regard, we're talking about sound counsel, which is God's original plan, God's original thought, God's purpose for your life, for an organization, for a community, for a nation. It must be brought to God. It must be brought to God in subjection for clearance. So if God says that, take this element out, take that element out, this is how you go about it, this is actually what I want you to do with regards to this thing that you have brought, then God helps you to put that thought, helps you to put your imagination in proper perspective of his plan and his purpose for your life. In verse 6 of Proverbs 24, it stresses it again, for by wise counsel thou shalt make thy war, and in the multitude of counselors there is safety. There is safety. So the tendency for your thoughts or your mind or your imagination to run wild and to begin to desire things that are unholy or things that are not in line with God, you know, and his plan for your life is very, very high when you do not submit it for counsel. In this regard, the counsel of God. It says, there are many devices in a man's heart. Nevertheless, the counsel of the Lord that shall stand. The purpose of God, the plan of God, because there is a plan exists. Okay, and the only way your life can make meaning, the only way you can walk accurately is to ensure that your thoughts are in alignment with his thoughts. You remember in Isaiah chapter 55, it was there that God said, my thoughts are not your thoughts. And because my thoughts are not your thoughts, my ways are not your ways. It's not that they cannot be. It's not that your thoughts cannot be God's thoughts, or your way cannot be God's way. But God is saying in verse of Isaiah, verse 8 of Isaiah, it says, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. You know, he had established, God had established, you know, after he brought destruction to the world in Genesis, that was Noah. After that experience, God said that he realized that the thoughts of the imagination of men from their youth has been evil continually. In Genesis chapter 8, verse 21, scripture says, "And the Lord smelled a sweet savour, and the Lord said in his heart, I will not again curse the ground anymore for man's sake, for the imagination of man's heart is evil from his youth. Neither will I again smite anymore everything living as I have done." So the emphasis there is, for the imagination of man's heart is evil from his thought. And the point that this is stressing is that our imagination, you know, aligns with the human passions, fleshly passion. Okay, remember when Jesus Christ was having a conversation with Peter, and Jesus was telling him about how that he was going to suffer in Jerusalem, how that he was going to be crucified. Okay, and then on hearing this, Peter said, the Bible actually literally said that Peter began to rebuke Jesus Christ, saying to him that far be it from you, it will never happen to you. And then in response, Jesus addressed Satan. Okay, he said, "Get thee behind me, Satan, for thou savourest not the things that be of God, but the things that be of men." So what is the point here? When Peter began to say those words, Satan began to walk on the imagination of Jesus Christ. The words that Peter was using were words that were appealing to his passion, his human feeling. Okay, so it was heightening the feel of pain and how, you know, he will withdraw from pain. Because naturally, as man, flesh, we withdraw from pain and we tend towards pleasure, all right? But Jesus, having known the plan of God, all right, he knew what exactly was expected of him. And as he began to tell Peter what was expected of him and how that those things will find fulfillment, concrete fulfillment in his life, Peter began to respond with the human passion and said, "No, you are not going to die. Somebody like you is too good to die. You shouldn't die. We shouldn't lose you. We need more of you to spread across the earth." But he did not know. Now, it sounds very okay, sounds very nice from Peter's perspective, because yeah, when you see somebody who is doing good, you would rather that there are many of such persons scattered all over the place. But that was not the agenda. What may look good may not necessarily be God. And that's the point where your imagination must not pass for vision until it has been submitted to God for clearance. And that's the point that I'm trying to make to us today, that I'm trying to put across to us today. So Jesus Christ said to Satan, "Get behind me," because in your own case, the only thing that you fan to flame, the only thing that you season are human passions, human desires. I mean, somebody will say, "Well, I mean, are you trying to say that God is against us becoming comfortable or becoming rich or, you know, having means, having resources?" And the point is that, you know, even resources and means are a means to an end and not an end in themselves. And that is where you need to be careful the kind of thoughts and ideas that come to your mind. Some thoughts, the way they are presented like, "Ooh, fantastic. They are wonderful," but they have, you know, an evil end. I give you a practical example. You remember the story about, I mean, the issue about Esther being in the palace and how Haman planned for the destruction of the Jews. If you read that book very well, you will discover at the point that Haman was selling the idea to the king, because Haman went to the king, all right, to report the Jews to the king and to make a case for the destruction of the Jews. You would remember that Haman said to the king that there is a people in your kingdom. They have a diverse law from the law of Shushan, and these guys are detrimental to your reign. They are detrimental to your kingdom. I think if we continue to allow these guys to leave, they are going to one day bring your kingdom down. Now, when the king heard what Haman said, it sounded like a noble agenda. It sounded like a noble cause. Of course, nobody will want to entertain what is going to destroy his kingdom at the end of the day. And so the king bought into that idea because the idea, the thought, the imagination that was being painted to the king and which the king was already playing out in his mind looked like something that was going to benefit the king. Albeit, it was the selfish idea of Haman. Can you see where you have to be careful with ideas that are being sold to you? People come to you and sell ideas to you and tell you, this is a noble cause. This is a vision that is worth pursuing. And you join forces with that person and you begin to run with that vision. Albeit, this vision is only designed to benefit the person in question. It is not a vision from God. It was actually an ambition that this person had, but came and presented it as a noble vision, a noble cause for you to run with. Remember Jehoshaphat and Ahab. Ahab had told Jehoshaphat that I have a mission that I want to, you know, embark upon. Let's get into it together. And Jehoshaphat, you know, was going to follow him and said, let's inquire. Even after all the inquiries were made, and the prophet Micah had told them that if you return, God did not send me, you know, God did not, you know, call me to be a prophet. You know, even after that had been said, Jehoshaphat still went on this mission with Ahab, thinking that it was a noble cause. I mean, why will somebody be fighting with my own ally, you know, be trying to destroy my own ally, and then I do not team up with my own ally to destroy the enemy? Because if the enemy, you know, is able to overpower my ally, one day he's going to come after me. You see how sweet, how good, how nice it looks and it sounds. And then they went for that mission together. They went on that mission together. And at some point, the battle was against Jehoshaphat. And the enemy was running after Jehoshaphat until Jehoshaphat cried out and said, I am not the person that you are looking for. I'm not Ahab. And then when they discovered that it was not Ahab, they had to turn back from, you know, following him. And then they went after Ahab until Ahab was brought down to his knees and he was killed, according to what Prophet Micaiah said. So the point is, there are so many ideas and there are so many thoughts and there are so many causes that look very good. The scripture that I started out with, Proverbs chapter 19, verse 21, there are many devices in a man's heart. Nevertheless, the counsel of the Lord, that shall stand. You must be able to know what the counsel of God is. Even if you have a thought, even if you have a desire, even if something is brewing in your heart, in your imagination, you must not run with it until you have submitted it to God, according to 2 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 5, for clearance. You must submit it to God for clearance, because a vision is only a glimpse of, you know, the sum total of God's plan for your life. It's a glimpse of the sum total of God's agenda, of God's purpose for creating you, for having you, you know, in this life. Praise God. So it's not enough for an idea to be brilliant. It's not enough for an idea to sound good if you don't take it through the test. Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. If it doesn't go through that test, you will be surprised that what sounds good, what looks good, what looks like a worthy and a noble cause to run after, turns out to be an ambition that will lead to your destruction. Praise God forevermore. I think that you have enough material, enough information to think upon today. What's wrong with imagination? I've just told you in this broadcast what could be wrong with imagination. Imagination does not pass for vision until you have submitted it to God, you know, for clearance. Until you have submitted it to God for clearance. That's when your thoughts, that's when those brilliant looking ideas can only pass for vision. Praise God forevermore. Hallelujah. I believe that God has spoken to you. I believe that you've received some thoughts, some instructions and directive from God that will help you going forward to analyze those thoughts that are coming up in your heart, to analyze the thoughts and the imaginations and the ideas and the desires, you know, and the causes and the initiatives that people are bringing to you, all right? They may sound very good, they may look very fantastic, but I've given you two instances in scripture. The case of Haman, who went and sold an idea to the king, but he sold the idea to the king as if it was only going to benefit the king. He sold the idea to the king as if it was in the interest of the king, whereas he is the Alpha and the Omega of the whole idea. He is the one at the center of the idea, but it looked like a noble cause. It looked like a fantastic idea, brilliant one to pursue. All right, and then, you know, he fell for it. But you will find out, if you read the book of Esther very well, you will find out in the end that the destruction of the Jews would have meant the destruction of Shushan. It would have destroyed the palace entirely, because we found eventually that Esther and Mordecai were instrumental to the successful reign of the king. Hallelujah. And then, of course, I told you about the case of Jesus's conversation with Peter, who was telling Jesus that, no, you are too good to die. You should not die. Far be it from you. God forbid that you should die. You are not the kind of person that should die. As a matter of fact, we need more of you. You are a good person. You are doing good. You are healing the sick. But Jesus was telling him that death was imminent for me. I must die. The agenda of God is that a corn of wheat must fall into the ground and die so that it can bring forth many of me. So while he was thinking that the way to have many of Jesus was to have many other human beings like him come into the earth at that time, Jesus said, no, that's not God's way of achieving it. God's way of achieving it is that I must die. I must go into the earth. And as a corn of wheat, as I go into the earth, I will bring forth much fruit. There will be many Jesuses. There will be many saviors that will be able to do the kind of things that I am doing and bring righteousness into the earth. So what looks like a brilliant idea may not be a brilliant idea after all. What looks like a brilliant thought may not be a brilliant thought after all. It may actually be leading to destruction unless you bring that thought, that imagination for clearance. You bring it to God for clearance. You bring it to the obedience of Christ. You bring it in subjection to Christ. Then Christ will look at it and say, no, you can't run with this. This is what this is going to lead to. Or you say, take this element out. Add this one to it. Do it like this. You know, then you will now have his full support to run with those thoughts, with those imaginations that are coming out of your heart. Because it is only the counsel of God that will stand ultimately, not in the short term, not in the medium term, but for all time, for eternity. It is only the counsel of the Lord that stands. Praise God forevermore. I want to draw the curtains at this time so that I can allow us to meditate, you know, upon the thoughts that I have put across unto us today. And I trust God that He is going to open our understanding and is going to help us to be able to discern, you know, amongst the many ideas, many, you know, brilliant looking ideas, many brilliant looking thoughts, many brilliant looking causes, many brilliant looking initiatives that are coming either from our own heart or that people are presenting to us. If truly it is from God, after we have presented it to him for clearance. Then we will know whether we should run with it or not. You don't run with an idea because it's coming from somebody that you know. You don't run with an idea because you know you are sure of the source of it. If you have not yet submitted it to God for clearance, it is until you have done that, that you, it's only when you have done that, that it passes for a vision, for something that you run with. God bless you. God bless you. I appreciate you. Thank you, my wonderful brother, Pastor Wale Adekwegba, Sister Wumi, okay, my brother Tokumbo, okay, Pastor Dipo Kilanshe, okay, and I've also acknowledged a few persons before. And I appreciate you for joining this broadcast today, and looking forward to seeing you next week. Last week I had said that it was this week we're wrapping up with vision for the month of October, but we still have one more Saturday, which is next week Saturday, so we'll be bringing the talk on vision to a close next week Saturday, that is the 31st of October, and then we will be entering into the month of November. In the month of November, we are going to be discussing influence. It's powerful, it's awesome, it's profound, and I don't want you to miss any, you know, of the teachings that we'll be having in the month of November. We'll be discussing influence. God wants us to exert influence. He wants us to have influence in the earth. He wants us to have influence in the spaces that we occupy, you know, so that He can reign in every system. He can reign in every structure. He can reign in every kingdom. And then we will see the birth of righteousness in the earth. So I'm looking forward to the month of November, where we're going to be, you know, discussing all of the brilliant, brilliant secrets that God has for us that time. But in the meantime, next week, we are bringing the talk on vision to a wrap. And I would like for you to join when we will be doing that, as God has yet something profound to release to us on the subject of vision. Till then, I say goodbye. But before I cut off, I'd like for us to pray. Father, thank you for this day. Blessed be your name, for your word that came to us with power, came to us with great grace, came to us with great unction. I pray, God, that this understanding will advance us in life. It will help us to walk more accurately, more intentionally in fulfilling your counsel, your plan, your purpose for our lives as individuals, for our homes, for our families, for our communities, and for our nation, in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, everlasting Father. Blessed be your name forevermore. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Till I come your way again next week, 5 p.m. West African time. Bye for now.